Okay, so here we are. I'm Duncan Foley. This is the New School for Social Research. Our graduate PhD course, Advanced Microeconomics 2, Behavior and Information in Political Economy. And this is the third meeting of the course. So we're up to lecture 3, which is called Applications of the Entropy-Constrained Behavior Model. But I thought, in order to make sure that we have continuity, we better go back and look at review just quickly what the entropy-constrained behavior model looks like. And this connects up with a question that Kyle asked in the earlier, in the first meeting of the class, which is, what is the role of maximization? Which is a really important question, I think, and we're going to have to look at that much more carefully. So just to take a little step backwards, I just want to go back over the formalism of the entropy-constrained model and see if anybody, now that you've had a little chance to think about it, has questions about that that they would like to ask. The idea of this is to introduce more realism, if you will, more faithfulness to what we actually observe human behavior to be like, into the maximization paradigm which is behind economics. So, very likely when you first studied economics, like an intermediate microeconomics course as an undergraduate, the first thing you studied often is consumer choice. So you have something like a utility function or maybe indifference curve representation of preferences, and you think about maximizing utility or getting on the highest indifference curve you can for a given budget constraint. And that is the sort of classic way that economists think about it. As we'll see, and I'll explain more a little bit later today, it turns out that that type of behavior is almost impossible to reproduce. So we really want to think a little bit about whether it's an adequate way of thinking about human behavior, or whether there's some more flexible way, which is this entropy-constrained behavior model. The idea of the entropy-constrained behavior model is to maximize, yes, but to put a constraint, but not a budget constraint, an information constraint on the behavior of the individual. Talk about an individual, so you can think about it as a household like the consumer choice model, but it may also be a firm, or it might be any entity that's trying to make a decision, big entity like a corporation or a government department or something of that kind. And the idea is that the individual has a payoff function, which we call U of X, and has a action set, which we call capital X. This appears down here. And is supposed to be choosing actions from this action set. But we think now of not choosing just one action. What we think of is choosing a mixed strategy over the actions. So what the individual is doing is choosing a certain frequency of action. And that frequency is called f of x. So the expected utility is just the expectation of the payoff relative to this particular frequency. But what's under the individual's control now is the frequency of the action. Now, if we were just maximizing f of x, u of x, the expected utility, it's clear that what you do is you put all the frequency on the highest payoff on the highest payoff action. So you get a degenerate frequency distribution that just says, okay, the probability of doing the highest payoff action is 1, and the probability of doing everything else is 0. That's effectively exactly the same as the intermediate micro story. But it's precisely that characteristic of this theory that does not line up very well with experiment or with observations of the way that people, and in fact other organisms, other monkeys, rats, other subjects actually behave when they're faced with choices of this kind. In order to make it more, and the reason is that when you pose a choice question of this type, a behavior problem of this type to a subject, typically what happens is, yes, they show a strong preference for one action over another, in the sense that you see them do one action a lot more often than the other ones. But they almost always will do the other action some of the time. Now, just why this is true, we can discuss. Neuroscientists are going to be interested in this. We can talk about it. But for the moment, if we just are thinking about the mathematical representation of this idea, the way I would like to represent it is to say that the subject is maximizing expected utility. So that's just the maximization part. But subject now not to a budget constraint, but to an entropy constraint. So that the frequency distribution cannot fall below a certain minimum entropy level. And we introduce the concept of entropy in the first lecture, and you can go back and look at that again. Just to remind you, this turns out to be a very well-behaved constrained optimization problem, because the objective function, considered as a function of the frequencies, is linear, right? Each frequency is just weighted by the payoff of that particular action. And the constraint, which is stated by the entropy formula, the entropy is a strongly concave function. So this constraint defines a strictly convex set in the space of distributions, frequency distributions. So we have a very well-defined problem that maximizes a linear function as a function of in a strictly convex constraint set. So the result is always unique, and the first order conditions are both necessary and sufficient for global optimization. So let me just stop there for a minute and see if anybody has any question to follow up on this very basic point. And if you do have a question, we have a different microphone system, which Rachel has, so anybody want to ask? Okay, Rachel, you can sit down. They're not going to ask this time. All right. Maybe I can get them to ask on the next slide. All right. If you do this type of constrained maximization problem, we know that the way to do it, a typical way to do it, is through the Lagrange multiplier method. So we would take the objective function and we would multiply the constraint by a Lagrange multiplier and maximize that Lagrangian instead of the separate maximization and constraint setup. And when you do that, you get an expression which is extremely interesting. What this expression, this is the Lagrangian, and it's going to be depend on the frequency distribution, the mixed strategy that the individual decision maker chooses, and on the Lagrange multiplier, which we'll call capital T for this purpose. And the Lagrangian is equal to the objective function, which is just expected utility here, plus, because the constraint, you see, is written as a minimum constraint, so you have a plus, not a minus, as you would if you had a constraint, upper bound constraint. When you have a lower bound constraint, the sign changes. So you have T times the entropy of the distribution. And then you have this term, which is actually T times H min. So that is not, doesn't have any effect. The Fs don't have any effect on that term. Basically, then, what you're maximizing is the difference between the expected utility and this T, which we will call behavior temperature, times the entropy of the frequency distribution. That particular difference has a terminological expression. It's sometimes called the free utility or the free payoff of the decision maker. And that is by analogy, if you've done any thermodynamics, with the concept of free energy in thermodynamics, which has exactly the same form. It's the energy of the system less the temperature times the entropy of the system. It's called the free energy, free payoff. And you can see that the higher you make T, higher the entropy, the lower the entropy is going to be, okay, the way that this is set up. So there's a one-to-one correspondence between this minimum entropy and the temperature. As it turns out, it's much easier, we'll find that it's much easier to work always in terms of the temperature rather than actually explicitly talking about the minimum entropy constraint. So we'll just talk about an individual operating at a certain behavior temperature, T. Now, can I get anybody to ask a question? Kyle.
Okay, so I'm wondering if somehow behavior temperature can be like non-localized, I guess, or could it like apply to a system in which individuals participate, or must it always be, you know, localized with the individual? The individual is operating at a potential, at some behavior temperature, and that's, that explains the behavior, or I don't know. I mean, I just wonder if it has to be localized.
Is how localizable is this concept of behavior temperature? For example, suppose you had several people interacting in a game, let's say, or some kind of a bargain or negotiation, then you might want to have a behavior temperature for each of the participants in the negotiation, or in a cooperative setting like a corporation department or something like that, that the different people are trying to coordinate their activities. And the question is, do you have to assume that they all operate at the same behavior temperature, or could they operate at different behavior temperatures? Well, that's really a frontier question. I mean, nobody knows too much about this because people haven't studied this problem of behavior temperature from an economic point of view in any detail. So it may be that in analogy with physics, that if you have a bunch of actors who are involved in the same system, there's some process by which they tend to come to the same behavior temperature. Talk a little bit more about this at the end of today's lecture when we do the liar's poker. We'll talk about bond trading and liars, this liar's poker book from this point of view. But at this point, I'm not putting forward any equilibrium theory that that behavior temperatures are equalized, okay? It might be that they tend to be equalized, or it might be that that you see people interacting with very different behavior temperatures. Well, if I were out there, I would ask Professor Foley, what determines the behavior temperature? So let me just say a little word about that, and then we'll go on to the next group of slides. Well, approximately what determines the behavior temperature is this minimum entropy. And there's not a whole lot of theory understood about this, but there's some obvious clues that you can that you might be tempted to use if you want to explore this. First of all, the organisms that we're talking about, human beings, other mammals, and stuff like that, are finite organisms. And their brains are amazingly well adapted to doing decisions, to processing information. But clearly, the information processing capability of any particular individual is limited. You know, you only have so many neurons up there, and they're firing away. And in fact, the neurons are using, I think my son, who's, as I've said, is a neuroscientist, tells me that the brain uses, I think, over a quarter of the energy budget of the whole organism. So it's already soaking up an awful lot of what's available in terms of actual energy. So there's limited energy and there's limited computing capability up there. And as a result, you would assume that the organism, like the human being, has to partition or allocate this computational capacity among different things that are going on. So if you're trying to find your way in the forest and you're also trying to figure out where the game is in the forest, and you're also keeping an eye on the weather because it might be about to storm or something, you have several different processes that several different things you're paying attention to and that you're trying to make decisions about. So you would expect that you're going to partition your decision-making capacity among those different competing goals. And it's presumably that that results in the minimum entropy for any one of the decision tasks. But not very much is known, as I say, practically speaking, about that. Armand.
Yes, Professor Foley. I was wondering, usually we have this question about, one of the critiques of the rational agent is that there's a huge information set that the agent needs to know, and he needs to be rational or she. They need to know all the decision space. And so that is a valid critique, I would say, is that we don't know. There's imperfect knowledge. But it seems to me the problem that, as you posed it, is even more is requiring more information, because not only do I need to know what are my options, I don't need to know what the U's are, I also need to know what my minimum or maximum entropy is that I'm allowed to achieve. And given that, I would then have to choose the distribution. So it seems to me to be informationally or computationally more intensive than the usual problem that we encounter in microeconomics. And so I was wondering if that, how that then relates to the processes that you just described, and if it's a, is it an evolutionary argument, maybe, to say that our, through evolution we were able to maximize this problem that you're posing on the slide?
Okay, Armin's question, which is a very devastating question to the whole program and could bring the whole course to grinding to a halt right here, is this really computationally or informationally more economical than the usual full rationality assumption? Because it requires, Armin says, the decision maker to know the payoffs, but in addition to knowing the payoffs, to do this maximum entropy or minimum entropy kind of problem, minimizing entropy kind of problem. So is it really more parsimonious? Well, I would like to think about having a really good answer for that question. But in the meantime, I would try to argue that this is a pretty parsimonious way of trying to describe, if not explain, the behavior of real agents. And we'll talk about this in a moment when we look at some of the experimental evidence. So I'm not arguing that you do a kind of meta computation where you maximize in this way. What we're arguing is that this is a way of describing a certain kind of bounded rationality. And the boundedness could come at a variety of points in the process. I'll mention this again in a moment, but if we think of the organism as a stimulus response, if we think about this in terms of operant conditioning, so the stimulus is the choice situation, the X, that you have to choose some action, and the response is what you do, okay, or what the organism does. It might be a mouse in a maze, or another experimental subject of that kind. Then what this is saying is that if you look at that sequence between stimulus, the organism perceiving the stimulus, processing the stimulus, and acting, which is the basic neuroscience of line of neuroscience, that communication channel has some kind of limited capacity. The limited capacity is related to the number of neurons that are recruited to the neuronal networks devoted to solving the problem, to the proportion of the perception bandwidth that the individual uses, and to the precision with which the individual can control action. All of those things may be limited by the capabilities of the individual in a particular circumstance. And it's this general idea that the entropy constraint is trying to represent. Clearly, if you're marching through the forest looking for game, and all of a sudden you notice that a tiger is in the tree, I don't even know if tigers actually jump out of trees, but some kind of cats do, and they are not. It's not a good thing to happen. All of a sudden that's true, it's very likely that your allocation of your attentional resources or of these entropy resources will shift dramatically, right? And the main thing you're going to be looking for now is how to get away from the tiger. And you're not going to be so interested in making sure that the picnic lunch that you've brought with you is not spilling, or that you're walking on the shady side of the path and staying out of the sun, or any of those kinds of things. So you might see a sharp change. This is pretty relevant to economics, because we do see sharp changes in the precision with which people make decisions sometimes. So this at least gives us a language to talk about that. Okay, so that is the review of entropy constrained behavior. I just remind you one more thing, which is that you can actually solve this problem in a kind of general way. That is, you can differentiate this Lagrangian and find the first order conditions. And the first order conditions are of this form, that the payoff, when you differentiate with respect to any particular frequency f of x, you get a first order condition that says u of x, the payoff for that action, minus t times the log of f of x. And then there's a 1 in there due to, disappears when you normalize the probability distribution, is equal to 0. This tells you that the frequency, the expected utility entropy-constrained frequency, is proportional to, let's say, E to the U to the payoff divided by the temperature. And this is a very, very general thing. It doesn't depend on what the payoffs are or anything like that. You're always going to get this form of the behavior frequency distribution. If you normalize, that tells you that the frequencies have to be equal 2e to this payoff divided by the temperature divided by the sum over all the actions that you can do of those probabilities. That's called the Gibbs distribution because it comes up in statistical physics, the statistical physics of statistical mechanics, and the person who first developed it in detail is Willard Gibbs, the master of statistical mechanics. And it's very characteristic and very powerful insight. And it tells you that the pay, what's happening is that you're going to see the subject doing a given action more often the higher the payoff of that action is. So instead of it being a 0-1 decision, as in intermediate micro, where you pick the utility maximizing budget constrained bundle to buy, you actually will see the agents spread their behavior over all the possible bundles, but the highest frequency you'll observe is going to be the highest payoff bundle.
I just have a question regarding like the objective of this mechanism. Is this more like analogous to a theoretical description of how humans make decisions as in the standard microeconomics textbooks that we have, or is more of a way to analyze empirical data on decisions, like for example Samuelson's revealed preference mechanism?
So the question is do we want to regard this primarily as a theory of human behavior, or do we want to think of it primarily as a guide to data analysis or the analysis of data that arises from human behavior? And I would say definitely. Both. I mean, yes, you can think of it going one way as an attempt to be a more realistic, if you will, and because more boundedly rational, but very parsimonious description of human behavior, and therefore it has a theoretical role to play. And we'll see, I'm going to spend quite a bit of time on this, that in certain key problems of economic theory, for example, the problem of Bertrand competition, which is going to be central to some of our later discussion, this makes a huge difference whether you have a finite behavior temperature or not, in terms of just the pure theory. So I think that's right. But it also gives a lot of leverage in data analysis. And that's actually what I'm going to talk about in the next lecture slide series that we look at, because it generates endogenous variability of behavior. So that means, which I'll explain in just a moment, but let me summarize it now. So it means that what you look at econometrically and that you many people look at is error, okay? You know, let's say we're trying to explain the behavior of a household in terms of its consumption purchases. And when you plot real data, what do you see? Well, you don't see every household buying exactly the demand amount of the good, right? You see some kind of distribution there. Typically in econometrics, that distribution is regarded as noise, you know, as errors in measurement or something of that kind. But what this, if you look at it from this point of view, you'll see that those, that distribution, the variability that you see in data has information in it about the preferences of the individual, of the individuals. So it levers up the amount of information that you can infer from data that comes from human or animal, but we're going to mostly do economics with human beings, human observations.
Thank you. The fact that the UAX here just remains the same and we just add the T to our behavioral constraint, does it mean that, I mean, this framework the value based on which the individual actually rank its payoff remains the same, but it is possible that it doesn't, I mean, the individual doesn't actually like go with the highest payoff, but the value based on which it ranks the payoff remains the same all the time during the first.
Yeah, so the question Marjane is asking is, does the fact that the U of X appears in the Gibbs function in the way that it does mean that even when you change the behavior temperature, the payoffs on which are guiding the behavior stay the same? And the answer is yes. Now that doesn't mean in reality that something might not change your payoffs. You may discover that in fact you're prone to sunburn in this walk through the woods, which would mean that you would start keeping more in the shady side of the path or something of that kind. But that might be a learning. That might be part of learning. So in that sense, the payoffs might change. But that would not have to do with the change in T that came when you noticed the tiger, because in that case, you still have the same action set and the same goals. It's just now that you're looking at the whole situation with a lot more attention focused on avoiding the tiger. Does that help? Somebody else had a question here.
Just if you could help me understand this choice of words, maybe frequency. It seems to me that some choices, maybe the most important choices, come with like a frequency of one. Should I choose this education or that? Should I buy this house? Should I have this child? Whereas other choices come with like buy coffee at the deli or the fancy coffee store. Like, is it really a frequency, these choices?
That's a very good question. So Esben says, what is this frequency language really saying? And he gives the example. There are a lot of human actions that are what are called quantal. They're either ones or zeros. Either you do the thing or you don't. Or maybe there's only two or three choices of what you do. You buy one kind of car or another kind of car, but you can't, you know, that type of situation. And that is very true, and those are very important applications, actually, of this type of model. And the way that you understand it is you're going to say, let's take a typical individual faced with the choice, do I go to this educational program or that educational program? Let's say the payoff of one educational program is high and the other one is lower. Now, in conventional theory, you would say that person's always going to go to the high payoff program, right? The low payoff program is never going to get them. What this is saying is no. Depending on their behavior temperature, they will more often go to what they regard as the high payoff program, but sometimes they will go to the low payoff program. And we'll see in just a moment exactly the type of what's called quantal response that is implied by this kind of behavior, which turns out to be a very good description of the way that people actually behave in these quantal choice examples. Okay, so let me now move on to the applications of this entropy-constrained model and tell you a little bit about the history of it, which I already did last week, but I'll repeat it again and encourage any questions that you might have. One place to start this theory, you could start this story like any other story with Aristotle or with the Babylonian astronomers, or we'll get to the astronomers a little bit later. One place to start is after the Second World War with von Neumann and Morgenstern's book, The Theory of Games and Economic Behavior. And in the second edition, this is not in the first edition, but in the second edition, they prove a theorem that's called the expected utility theorem. And this relates actually Marjan, to your question. That theorem says, suppose that you have a subject who has complete and transitive and continuous preferences over lotteries. Now, a lottery is just what it says. It's a lottery is a choice of behavior that gives you one outcome with a certain probability and another outcome with another probability, or maybe a range of outcomes with all different probabilities with a frequency distribution. And that satisfy the additional assumption of the independence of irrelevant alternatives, which you can look into, but is not particularly important for the themes that I want to develop in this course. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the Neumann-Morgenstern axioms. I'm more interested in them as a background to this behavioral entropy-constrained behavior model. That she will act as if she can assign payoffs, okay, given payoffs, U of X, which are unique up to a linear transformation, an affine transformation, A plus B U of X. So they're like temperatures, like centigrade and Fahrenheit temperatures. You can change the zero point by changing the A, and you can change the size of the degree by changing the B, but that's it. So you don't have any more freedom than you do in measuring temperature. To alternative actions, X, and then chooses the lotteries to maximize expected payoff. Okay, that's the expected utility theorem. Now, there's a lot of literature about the fact that this doesn't work. And that literature goes in a lot of different directions. For example, this was the whole basis of the Kahneman-Tversky psychological experiments, and it's a number of other things. Leads to a whole host of other modifications of this expected utility hypothesis. I think much of this literature might not, in fact, do anything more than this entropy constraint does. And that's one of the reasons I like the entropy constraint point of view, because it's very parsimonious. It just adds one modification to this model. Because you see, the entropy constraint model we just looked at, where does it start? It starts from maximizing expected utility, right? With a given payoff, with a given set of payoffs. And it modifies it simply by adding this constraint on the entropy. Doesn't modify it by changing the Neumann-Morgenstern axioms in other respects. The frequencies that define the lotteries in the Neumann-Morgenstern story could be conceived to be objective or subjective. So if you're playing a gambling game, like Daniel Bernoulli was interested in, you might say, well, we're throwing the dice, and the dice are fair, and the dice come up seven a certain proportion of the time, and they come up two a certain proportion of the time, and that's sort of an objective frequency. Or it could be Bayesian subjective. So you're saying to yourself, well, my best judgment about where the bond market is going to go is such and such, and that's my subjective frequencies based on inference. But the point is that the probabilities or the frequencies that come into this calculation are accepted by the decision maker, and you take the expectation of payoffs with respect to those given frequencies. Now, you can understand this theorem most easily, I think, in terms of the following simple experiment, which is actually quite similar to a bond pricing experiment, a very abstract bond pricing experiment. Suppose there are outcomes A, B, and C, and you know that the decision maker prefers A to B and B to C. In fact, I would encourage anybody who has any interest, real interest in this, to get together and do this with each other's subjects a little bit and see what happens. This is the kind of thing you can do it yourself. Experimental economics works pretty well, and you can learn something from it. So if you're doing it with experimental economics, you can do it with kids. Okay, so you just make sure that that the kid prefers A. Let's say it's the candy bar, to C, which is orange juice or something. And then there's an intervening thing, B, which they definitely like better than orange juice, but not as much as the candy bar. Or if you're dealing with real people and you're willing to spend money, then a simple thing is to set A to be $10 and C to be $1 and B to be $5 in between. So, because we usually assume that there's people prefer more money to less money, so that's a simple way to do it. So the Neumann-Morgenstern axioms and theorem says that if you have this set up, there is a lottery that has the preferred prize A with frequency F and the not very preferred prize C with the frequency 1 minus F, such that the decision maker views that lottery as equivalent to getting the middle payoff B with certainty. So this is one way to think about it. You're tuning the F, the frequency, in such a way as to make the decision maker indifferent between the certain outcome B and this uncertain outcome, which is the lottery between A and C. And what this means experimentally is that in principle it ought to be possible, by doing an experiment of this kind, to find exactly what the decision maker's payoffs are for A and B and C, or at least their relative payoffs, because you have this affine transformation limit. So you're going to have to take B or something as the standard, as zero or something of that kind. But then once you do that and you establish some kind of a unit, then you ought to be able to say, well, yes, the decision maker likes A twice as much as C, or something of that kind. Precisely. Does anybody have any question about this point? Because this is crucial to getting your mind around what happens next. Oriel, yeah, just take the...
Thank you. So this is like a combination of the axioms of independence and continuity of like Neumann and Morgenstern.
Well, this is a form of, okay, Oriel says, is it a combination of the axioms of independence and continuity? This is a version of the von Neumann-Morgenstern expected utility theorem, which requires, I think I listed, complete, transitive, continuous preferences over the lotteries and the independence of irrelevant alternatives. And it's fairly famous that, in fact, real people don't behave this way.
Right, because there's the Allais paradox, and like there's a wealth of empirical evidence that says that actually we don't have this independence of...
Yes, well now, okay, so Oriel says there's the Allais paradox and, there's the Allais paradox and the Ellsberg paradox and a number of other critiques of this type of behavior. Curiously enough, none of these critiques seem to be phrased in terms of entropy or the information constraint. And one very good paper that someone could write, or even more than one person could write for this course, would be to look at the Allais and Ellsberg and or Ellsberg paradoxes in relation to the entropy-constrained behavior model and ask to what degree can the entropy-constrained behavior model resolve the Allais or Ellsberg paradoxes. So here's how you can visualize the expected utility experiment. the subject, we assume here U of B, that's the certain return, is 1, so that's our unit of utility. U of C is 0, and here's the frequency F going along here. So when the frequency is 0, the chance of getting the good prize A is 0. When it's 1, you're certain to get the good prize. Okay, so that's what is happening as you go along here. And we're measuring on the vertical axis the probability that the subject chooses the lottery over the certain return. And what the Neumann-Morgenstern theorem says is, well, that should start out at 0, because you know we've assumed that the subject prefers B to C, and you're going to get C with certainty if the frequency is 0. And you keep running it up, you run up the frequency. Well, that makes the lottery look better and better, because there's a better and better chance of getting the candy bar, the good prize. And there's a tipping point. And at that tipping point, but up until that tipping point, you never take the lottery. Kid always takes the middle prize. But at the tipping point, all of a sudden, the kid or the subject always takes the lottery. The lottery becomes suddenly more attractive than the certain prospect. And you can see that if we vary the utility of A, the payoff of the good lottery, if I increase that payoff, the effect of it is to lower the frequency at which this tipping point occurs. And if I lower the payoff to A, then I have to make it enrich the frequency, the chance you're going to get A, in order to make you tip over and take the lottery instead of the certain return. Now, after the Neumann-Morgenstern published this, it attracted the attention of a number of people, some of them economists, but also some of them psychologists. One particular one, Duncan Luce, who was a very, at that time, young and up-and-coming mathematical psychologist, was particularly interested in this. And there were other people like Patrick Suppes out at Stanford and a number of other of these early brilliant researchers, behavioral scientists. And they said, well, that sounds great. For one thing, these people mostly work for the RAND Corporation. And you can see that this kind of thing is of great interest from a military point of view, right? For example, deterrence. Let's say launching your nuclear weapon is the lottery, because you don't know what's going to happen, right? And so you're very interested in just how the payoff of, let's say, that's associated with your counterforce strategy or whatever the deterrent strategy is going to be. So that's one reason people were interested. It's also of great interest in stuff like bond trading, finance, politics, a whole range of very important applications. So they said, well, that would be great. So we really want to find out. Let's take some people, subjects, human subjects, and let's measure their payoffs by doing this experiment and finding out when they tip from the lottery to the certain return or vice versa. Well, what did they find? They found that sure enough, when you got people into this experiment, or got subjects into this experiment, when the lottery frequency of the good prize is very low, sure enough, subjects almost never took the lottery. Well, that looks like the prediction of the theory, right? You have a very low frequency of the good prize, and the lottery doesn't look attractive because you mostly are thinking, oh, I'm just going to get C, and I don't like C very much, and B is much better. Having B with certainty is much better. And that if you set the frequency of the good prize very high, subjects almost always took the lottery. But they never were able to get subjects to demonstrate this very sharp tipping point phenomenon. In fact, what happens is, and this is another thing if you are willing to sit around and have a beer and experiment with each other's payoff functions, and you can demonstrate this, I think. The experiments never showed this sharp step function that's predicted by expected utility theory. Instead, the frequency with which subjects took the lottery is always gradually rising. There's always some kind of continuous gradual increase in the probability from zero to close to one as you change the frequency over the range. And furthermore, for intermediate lottery frequencies, that is ones that are where it's on this upswing, subjects sometimes took the lottery and sometimes they didn't on different trials, even when they were offered the same lottery margin or chi. So are they maximizing or are they not maximizing? Well, it looks, when you see subjects do that, it looks like they're violating the transitivity axiom, right? Or some kind of consistency of preference axiom, because you put them in exactly the same situation, and sometimes they do one thing and sometimes they do another thing, which is not compatible with intermediate micro decision theory, because you're always supposed to do the same thing when you are confronted with the same constraints. Very disturbing. Also, if you start thinking about the implications of this for nuclear deterrence or for bond trading, you can see that it's very disturbing to a certain point of view about the way that markets work and the way that human behavior human beings interact with each other, say through markets or other types of institutions. So just so we have a very clear image of this, here's the same diagram, the step function diagram, which is in blue the way it was before. And this red is now the quantal response. In fact, what it is just the Gibbs distribution that comes from the entropy-constrained model, okay? And you can see in this case, the Gibbs distribution is going to have this S-shaped character, right? It's going to have this S-shape. When the frequency is very low of the good reward, the lottery payoff is low, and therefore you're not going to take it very often. And when the frequency of the good reward is high in the lottery payoff looks quite high, so you will very often take it. But there's this intermediate level where you sometimes take it and sometimes you don't. Okay. And if we change the utility of the good option up and down, it has the same effect, qualitative effect, as it did with the step function. But now we have this additional parameter, the behavior temperature. And now what happens? Well, as the behavior temperature goes up, the range of indeterminacy gets much bigger. And as the behavior temperature goes down towards zero, the quantal response, or the Gibbs function, gets closer and closer to the prediction of the Neumann Morgenstern theory. But it never gets exact. You can never make it happen exactly. I think I mentioned last week, but I'll just say it again, my son is running experiments of this kind. I mean, it's very interesting. He's a neuroscientist, so he has monkeys choosing between high variance and high, you know, reward and variance of reward, risk and return. And what they do is they train the monkeys, what he calls overtrain the monkeys, to try to get their behavior temperature down as low as possible. So he says that a well-trained monkey, now some monkeys train better than other monkeys. In fact, it's a curious thing that there's a monkey lineage of scientific papers. So in addition to the authors of the papers who get cited and get rewards and promoted for good papers, you can actually trace the monkey subjects of the good papers. And there are some monkey subjects that are like Einstein's of experimental neuroscience, because they train so well. So they train them, and he says you can train a good monk, what are called good monkeys, to the point where they may make only something like 7 errors in 10,000 trials. This is the kind of monkey you might want to be your bond trader, actually, if you start thinking about it. Okay, so you can get the monkey down to a very low behavior temperature in certain experimental circumstances. But if you just try to get the monkey to do this when they're in their cage and there's a bunch of other monkeys around and there's food around and all this kind of stuff, then they're not so good at it. They have to be sitting in a chair in something a little like a brainwashing situation to get down to really low behavior temperature. Now, I'm not suggesting that you tie any of your fellow graduate students to chairs and try to train them to a low behavior temperature, but you might try some other, if you do a little experiment with this, you might try some other distractions or something. In fact, if you look at this, what happens when the behavior temperature gets to be very high? When the behavior temperature gets to be very high, it looks like the subject is kind of acting at random. Hardly any information coming out of it, right? Got to get the behavior temperature, get the behavior temperature down, and all of a sudden it looks like they're doing something. Now, I don't know, Kyle, if this is relevant, I think, to your question. Is there maximization here? Well, there is a kind of maximization, because you're getting the payoff, the high payoff, you're seeing the high payoff behavior more often. But there's not exact maximization, because you're not seeing it absolutely regularly. Marjan.
Just related to the last question, and using the language of like risk-taking behavior. So when we actually play with T, and that red line changes, we are actually saying that the individual remains in the same risk-taking behavior. For example, it is as risk-taker as it was, as she was, but as we play with T, still it performs different behavior, right?
Yes. Not at the extremes. At the extremes, for, let's say, small variations in T, her behavior hardly changes at all. That is, if it's a no-brainer, right? If the choice is definitely go for it or definitely don't go for it, then the temperature doesn't matter that much. But when you start getting into difficult choices, these intermediate choices, then the temperature makes a big difference.
So it's not that it takes more pleasure from taking more risks.
No, it seems to be, the question Marjana is asking, it's not a question that the payoff changes or with the risk. What is changing is, the attention, you might think of it as attention, or the information, the amount of information that the subject is processing. So it's a different dimension. It's not just payoff versus risk. It's also how much attention you're. For example, if let's say you're trying to sell somebody something. Okay, and you're setting a price, which is effectively this frequency, and you would like them to get them to buy it at a low price, right? Sometimes. Well, it might be to your advantage if you could somehow manipulate their behavior temperature so as to make it more likely that at least by accident they would sometimes go for this really bad deal that you're offering them. Well, what are some ways that you might manipulate their behavior temperature? Okay, it's Matt, right? What's your name? Daniel. Yeah, Daniel says, well, you might do it by high pressure sales technique. So if they're being screamed at by you, and especially if what you're screaming at them is a whole lot of distracting misinformation. So you're trying to get them to think about whether they're attractive to their sexual partner, whether they're, living up to their national duties or anything except, is this a good mortgage deal, right? Esmond.
I was thinking about, I know the name of this class is micro, but how the agents are affected by each other and each other's choices. And it was actually because you mentioned the RAND Corporation, I came to think about there's some kind of like, I want to say collective action, but maybe I should limit myself to say prisoner's dilemma, some kind of, and now that you said this thing to Daniel about screaming at people, I was thinking about universal healthcare. There's a lot of screaming around that issue, and there's a lot of like the benefit of that, choosing that action and the potential. I'm just trying to understand like collective action within this micro framework with this as an
Okay, so Esmond is saying that he wants to think about the interactive aspects of this. What happens if people are interacting, not just making a choice, but they're actually, say, strategically interacting or have some kind of institutional interaction. Specifically takes up the case of the political issue of universal health care, which is a quite reasonable thing. I mean, you could think that the person who's trying to sell is not necessarily a mortgage, trying to sell people on signing onto a certain kind of mortgage, but it's a politician trying to sell people to vote for one or another healthcare policy. Sure, that's exactly right. I actually think the course will meet your expectations pretty well, but you're going to have to be a tiny bit patient because it's the next topic starting either late today, but probably next week, where we're going to look at this, what's called the social interaction model, which is an explicit representation of exactly the type of institutional interaction that you're talking about. And to me, what's really interesting is the interplay between the social interaction elements and these information elements. Oriel, did you?
Like, there have been experiments like trying to find like correlations between T, the temperature, and for example, I don't know, the payoffs of the lottery, you know, like not only like the probability, but also like, for example, I don't know, if there's like a very high payoff, maybe I like there will be more temperature, because I will like try to, you know, like maybe I can get like it like promotes like risk, how to say, like not risk averse behavior, just the opposite. Like then maybe there's like some interactions between like temperature and like the payoff, or also like the amount of trials that you're doing. Because maybe, I don't know, if you do like a lot of trials, maybe like it also like you try, you know, like to increase like the probability, like to operate more like at taking the lottery more, or like taking the lottery less if you're like more risk averse, etc. Like, is there like some experiments on trying to check that with the temperature?
So Oriel's asking, are there experiments that try to study the relation of behavior temperature to behavior and the outcomes of these kinds of experiments? Well, there's a couple of, in a way, yes, and in a way, no. There are experiments that can be interpreted in that way. But you remember that we saw that if you are operating within the framework of the entropy constraint model, then you can't tell the difference between the intensity of preference and the decision temperature. If you look back at the end of last class's lecture, I showed that what you can establish by this kind of work is the relationship B over T, but you can't find B or T separately. I would say that it's a huge frontier would be for people to find some plausible way to control independently for decision temperature. And so you might give some thought to that, but I don't think people have thought about it quite this way. For example, Luce thought that this phenomenon did not associate this phenomenon with the Gibbs distribution and decision temperature. He associated this phenomenon, which he documented, you know, that was beyond question that this was how people behave, how subjects behave. He associated it with the subject being uncertain as to her own payoffs, sort of along the lines of Marjan's questions, right? So his idea was the reason that you sometimes take the lottery, if you're here, you sometimes take the lottery and sometimes you don't, because the probability is, you know, close to a half, is that you are uncertain about the payoffs. So there's some noisiness in your perception of your own payoffs, which is another way to think about where this kind of phenomenon might come from. Daniel?
Could we conceive of a situation potentially where the outcomes might be so desirable or undesirable as to change the behavioral temperature in general?
Sure. I mean, that's exactly what happens at these extremes. See, even, I mean, if you're down here, I mean, this is a really bad deal. So you have to be really pretty distracted to take it. And this is a really good deal, and you have to be not paying much attention not to go for it, right? So you do have that phenomenon built into the scheme. Jang asks, is there any way to make it absolutely horizontal, which would correspond to completely random choice, right? I mean, 50-50. Well, the answer is yes, but in that case, t has to go to infinity. So if you look at when t goes to infinity, you'll see that the payoff no longer has any impact on the behavior. And t equals infinity is effectively the case where the entropy has to be, the minimum entropy is very large, or goes to infinity too, which means that the behavior has to become effectively uniform over all of the actions that are available, and therefore not. And maybe that's another interesting angle on this question of, is it maximization? Because that's another sense in which it sort of, the maximization kind of disappears, because the influence of the payoffs on the behavior becomes buried in noise, right? I mean, just disappears into the noise level of the entropy. Yeah, in your... Alex, yes, Alex.
quick question. What is the analogous situation in the physical world for the temperature going or T going to infinity?
Center of the sun. Plasmas. Right? And the zero is absolute zero, so that's super cool. The very low temperatures are where are analogous to physical systems that are super cool in that way. Richard.
What is the weak points of this theory and what critique you have received from other economies?
There are no weak points in this theory. When I was in high school, we would kid around about a great German scientist whose main book was called My Theories Are Right. And you know, I feel a little bit like this. I think that there are clearly debates, especially in the psychological literature, over, say, Luce's alternative to this, which actually has exactly the same phenomenological form. It gives you exactly the same Gibbs distribution, but he does not motivate it by a constraint on entropy. He motivates it through this uncertainty about the payoffs, that the subject is uncertain about the payoffs. So this is a case where you have one of these interesting theoretical cases where you have two theories that sound like they're very different, but at least for a certain range of observations, they're equivalent. They have exactly the same predictions. Well, I would say this, that the evidence for this kind of behavior is overwhelming, and I've quoted it some in these notes. But the two places you can look for it are in the psychological literature on this type of experiment. And you find the quantal response is, I mean, Luce found the quantal response from the subjects that he was working with. He figured it out. He said, well, that's what's going on here. And the other important literature on this, if you want to read it, is the, which I actually would encourage you to read, is the work that Dan McFadden and Chuck Mansky particularly did in the 1980s from an econometric point of view on quantal response models. And in both cases, they also did not motivate the quantal response from an entropy limitation. But they showed phenomenologically that the quantal response is fabulously effective econometrically. So if you're doing things like, Esben was asking about the quantal decisions, like am I a homeowner or a renter, or am I, you know, what level of education do you have, and all of those kinds of decisions. The models the econometric models that address those questions are always phrased as quantal response models. This goes also to Jose's question about, is it more a behavioral theory or is it more an econometric method? So it is both. And as an econometric method, it has this very, very strong track record. So I would, for the moment, yes, maybe you want to nitpick over that, but I think that if you look into it a little bit, you'll see that the experimental or observational evidence for this kind of behavior is really quite strong, and you may be able to find some particular context in which it doesn't work, which would be interesting. But and if you want to write a paper about that, that's fine. For me. Kyle.
I want to try to think through an example and maybe just to see if I'm getting this right. Say you observe a person who, I guess, reports that they value, you know, A over B, but you see them over time frequently choosing B over A. Mm-hmm. Now, within this framework, rather than say that this person is misreporting their payoffs, we would just say that they are obviously distracted in some way such that they are making the decision that they wouldn't make under normal circumstances. And that's explained by T.
Okay, so Kyle brings up the question of intransitive behavior, which is extremely common in when you actually observe human behavior, where somebody says, yes, I prefer A to B, but when they're offered the choice between A and B, sometimes they take B and sometimes they take A. Well, that's exactly what the entropy-constrained model would it predict, right? Because it says, well, yes, the frequency with which they choose A is going to be the Gibbs distribution with the payoff, their payoff for A in it, versus B, and then you're going to normalize that, and you're going to get something like this. So, yes, that's a very good example of the kind of behavior that can be rationalized in this way. The only thing I would be a little careful of is your use of the term normal circumstances. See, because I would say the normal circumstance is that everybody's operating at a non-zero decision temperature. So what's the abnormal circumstance is the intermediate micro case, where all of the weight goes on the payoff maximizing outcome. Jose.
That comment, I don't know why, but it made me think a little bit on, again, on the revealed preference axiom.
Yes.
And there's usually a critique on that is not falsifiable. Would you argue that this framework is falsifiable?
I think the question Jose asks is, what does this have to say about, for example, revealed preference theory? And the question is, revealed preference theory falsifiable? Now, the usual argument about falsifiability of revealed preference is that when you get violations of, say, the weak axiom of revealed preference, you can't tell whether they're due to a violation of the behavioral postulate or whether the person's preferences have changed in between the two trials. Well, that you can't. There's nothing you can do about that. If the people, if preferences are changing between the trials, then they're just changing between the trials, and you don't have successive trials. I personally think that if you think about the world along these lines, you will find that preferences or payoffs look a lot more stable than they do when they're looked at through the lens of the pure revealed preference theory. And another excellent paper for this course would be to look at what the weak axiom of revealed preference looks like when you add an entropy constraint. In fact, there are a number of interesting, which I'll maybe bring up in a moment. Okay, so this slide is about the history of the logic quantal response idea, and goes back to Luce, who was a pioneer in this. And as I said, he showed that the experimental data could be very closely fitted by a logistic sigmoid curve of this form. And he proposed actually a whole book, which made him quite famous and is still very influential in psychology, of an alternative axiomatized theory of choice under uncertainty to the von Neumann-Morgenstern theory. So if you're interested in the history of this kind of behavioral theory, you might want to look at Luce's psychological theory and see where it diverges. And this leads to an enormous literature in economics over trying to rationalize observed deviations from the expected utility theory by one or another modification of expected utility theory. Luce derived the logistic quantal response from the assumption that the subject is uncertain about her own payoffs. And as I said to Richard, what's interesting about this is that you can't tell the difference between that hypothesis and the entropy-constrained hypothesis. The main advantage, to my view, of thinking about it in terms of entropy constraints is that when you think about it in terms of entropy constraints, you are connecting economics to a much wider range of scientific investigation that includes statistical mechanics, statistical physics, and all of the tradition in science that's centered around information theory and the implications of information theory for the way systems behave. But it's true that Luce's, you know, for these specific examples, Luce's derivation is just as good as this one. This one's much easier to remember and much easier if you're ever going to teach it to, it's much easier to teach students of economics how to maximize expected payoff subject to an entropy constraint, because you saw that. I mean, that just falls out. It's one line, and get the Gibbs distribution. So maybe that's a good pedagogical idea. It's also possible to derive the foundational principles of a lot of psychophysics. Psychophysics is called psychophysics because the people who were first involved with it were physicists. So in the late 19th century, people like Helmholtz and others were spending about half their time on electricity and things like that, and about half their time on human behavior. And one famous element of that is the Weber-Fechner law. Well, I don't know if you know the Weber-Fechner law, but it's the law of just noticeable differences. And it argues that the just noticeable difference, for example, suppose you take a subject and you make two mild pinpricks. Also, don't, if you're going to do this with your fellow graduate students, be very gentle with the pinpricks, or you can just use rubber erasers or something. So if you put two rubber erasers on somebody's arm far apart, they can tell that they're two. There's two different stimuli. You have to blindfold them, or they close their eyes or something. And then if you move the stimuli closer and closer together, there comes a moment when they can't tell whether it's two or one. Okay? Well, you can see that that's essentially the same phenomenon, right? Because when you get to that point where the lottery and the certain alternative are sufficiently close in payoff, the subject has a hard time telling which one is which. And that's why you get the quantal response type of phenomena. And in the 1980s, McFadden and Mansky particularly took this up. And if I would recommend that if you're interested in the observational end of this and the econometric end of this, it's well worth reading what they have to say about these quantal response models. These slides summarize the discussion that we really just had with the help of your questions, that there's a lot of experimental support for this type of behavior. If you stop and think about it, you probably think this is the way people behave anyway. That when you give them very, very tough choices, their behavior becomes a lot more random than when you give them very clear choices. The constrained entropy theory is also a parsimonious way to introduce random variation into models of behavior. So this touches on Jose's point and Kyle's point. As with other information-based theories, it has the advantage that it gives meaning to the non-systematic elements of observed behavior. So when you look at your scatter plot or whatever it is that your data, however you present your data, instead of seeing the dispersion of the points around the, let's say, the regression line as noise that you want to minimize, you can now see it as having some information in it if what the data you're looking at has to do with human behavior. Because now you would say, well, sure, it looks like it's unlikely for the household to be very far away from the demand point. But how far away it is from the demand point and how often we see a household that far away from the demand point, in fact, tells us something about the payoffs that the household is responding to. So econometrics, suddenly you get an inversion of econometrics. My complaint about traditional econometrics is that it focuses too much on the errors. I don't care about the errors. What I want to know is the relationship. So I'm very happy to have a model that incorporates the errors into the informational structure that we're looking at. So we get rid of noise. Okay, we can think of decision makers. Somebody asked this question and we talked about it a little bit, but let me go through this slide again. One motivation for this theory of entropy-constrained behavior is the view that human decision makers and other organisms that you might be interested in, or in fact, larger entities such as corporations or firms or that are trying to make decisions, can be usefully viewed as communication channels with limited bandwidth. So why do you even have the corporation? Presumably you've got all these people running around the corporation largely to try to increase the bandwidth of the corporation's decisions, right? And therefore to lower the behavior temperature at which the corporation makes big decisions like investing very large sums of money in building malls around Columbus, Ohio, or whatever the corporation is trying to do. And they don't want to make even small errors if they can avoid that, because every small error they make is one big amount of money. So we can think of the decision environment, the action set X, as a stimulus, and the observed action of the individual, the particular action that they take, as a response. The tendency of responses to cluster statistically in accordance with the Gibbs law presumably reflects either learned or evolved behavior. So you're going out hunting in the forest and you know where the game is likely to be. Maybe after you've done it a few times, you know where the tigers are likely to be too, right? So after a while, you develop a much better idea of what the payoffs are. And that's the learning element in these things. The residual variance of observed behavior then is going to be due to this limited bandwidth. And we mentioned that you can think of the limited bandwidth at any point in the communication channel. So some of the limited bandwidth comes from the fact that the perception of that the organism has of the environment is limited. Some of it has to do with their processing of the perceptual information through neuronal networks. And some of it has to do with limited control over the actual action. All of those elements may contribute to this limited bandwidth. Well, let's walk through a couple of examples. Yeah, remind me your name.
Advait.
Just before we get to the concrete example, I just want to ask about the last statement which you said about how there may be some noise, for lack of a better word, at the perception stage, at the process stage, and at the stage when the action is actually being carried out. Now, I want to know, can we differentiate between the increase or decrease in behavior temperature that comes from this process, from this neural process, and the changes in temperature that come from being part of a network or means how somebody else's behavior temperature impacts your own? Can we differentiate between those two? Is it necessary to do that?
Picking up on the idea that there are various phases of limited bandwidth, perceptual information processing and behavioral, or actual action. asks, is there any way you can tell the difference? And in particular, can you distinguish, for example, neuronal limitations to behavioral behavior from noise and perceptual ones? And my answer to that is that if you wanted to, that would be a great lifetime research question. And I mean that very seriously, because it has applications all over the place. And if you could figure out, in even a very simple case, a plausible way to answer your own question and identify the different sources of these behavioral temperature phenomena, you would find you could write huge number of publishable papers. I don't know if that's exactly an answer to the question, but I think it's correct. So I would encourage you very much to think along those lines. I think that's just an excellent way to think about these problems. Okay, so let's look at the simplest case, which is quadratic utility. Okay, so the quadratic utility function, let's say, is minus 1/2 x squared. We know that's maximized when x is equal to 0, and at x equals 0, the individual is satiated, right? You can't get any higher utility than that because the utility function is a parabola, and it reaches its absolute maximum at 0. What is the Gibbs distribution corresponding to the quadratic? Well, the Gibbs distribution corresponding to the quadratic looks like this. It's e to the minus x squared over 2t. And if you normalize that, you're going to find that there's a normalization constant, the square root of 2 pi times the square root of t. Does that look familiar? That is the normal probability, the Gaussian normal probability distribution. How did I get it in here? I got it in here by starting from the simplest utility or payoff function that I could think of, namely a quadratic. Interesting. Okay. So this is telling us that there's a relationship between models of behavior and models of probabilistic inference and noise. And here we see it smack in the face because you have the Gaussian probability. You'll notice that we derive, well, I'll get back to this in a minute. I hope I have enough time to do that before the end of class because it's a good way to end class. We did this without talking about the central limit here. I'm going to skip this part and actually go to the skip a little ahead, and then we'll come back to this next week. Where did the Gaussian normal model come from, anyway? Well, it came from astronomy. In the 18th century and the 19th century, astronomers, who were often mathematicians, moonlighting, if you'll excuse the expression, or the other way around, bought early model telescopes. Everybody wanted a telescope because Galileo got famous with the telescope, so everybody thought, oh, I want a telescope and I'm going to become a famous scientist. And they started to do things like try to measure astronomical phenomena, such as the position of particular stars with a high degree of precision. So that's how you start off. You do a simple problem, like you're going to measure where these stars are. So you point your telescope at the stars. So you do this night after night, and you're using up your eyesight and everything, and you're writing it down, and you find out that on different nights, the star is in different places. Not very different places, but somewhat different places, right? Even though you've set your telescope up the same, you have the same system for measuring the angles that it's looking at and all that kind of stuff, the star seems to be moving around. So you think about that a little bit, and in fact, there's a big discussion about whether the stars might not be moving around. But then you start to think about how far away the stars are, and you think about how much they'd have to be moving if they were that far away for you to be making these different measurements of their position, you say, no, that's not what's going on. The stars are not moving. Or they may be moving, but they're not moving that fast or anything like that because they're way, way too far away. Then what do? You say, well, I don't have a good enough telescope. So you go to your funder, who's the local duke or something, and you persuade him to give you a grant to buy a better telescope, right? So you get this better telescope from Leiden, or wherever it is, and you set it up on your table, and you start looking through it, and the goddamn star is jumping all over the place. It's not a question that night after night it's moving a little bit. Right when you're looking at it, it's jumping all over. So then what do you do? Well, first of all, you start worrying about your family are moving around in the downstairs and there's traffic in the street or something, so you put rubber mounts on the telescope and all that. And sure enough, you reduce the jumping around, but not really completely by any means. So then you're Gauss, and you say to yourself, well, what is going on here? Why is the star jumping around? And you, because you're a mathematician, a brilliant mathematician, you posit a model. And the model that you posit is that large star jumps are much rarer than small. In fact, you posit that the frequency of the size of star jumps declines, roughly speaking, with the square of the size of the jump. So a jump of twice as big is one quarter as likely. Okay. And because you're Gauss, which means not only you're a brilliant mathematician, but you're exceedingly lucky, it turns out that this guess is very close to right, amazingly right. And in fact, what do you propose? You say, well, the log of the frequency is going to be proportional to minus the size of the jump. And then you get that the frequency is going to be proportional to e to the minus 1/2 x squared over some standardization sigma. And then you're Gauss, so you know how to integrate that, which is not a trivial problem, and you can find the constant of integration. And you have a formula that actually works. And not only that, you begin to think about this, and you begin to realize that if the observed error in your telescope is due to the sum of a whole bunch of tiny little errors, as it very likely would be if it's coming from the fact that the starlight is passing through many layers of the atmosphere, then you can prove the central limit theorem. And you've formulated a reason why you have the normal distribution for these errors. But look, and this will pick up next week, is this really a very good derivation of the error of an error model for human behavior? I will leave that for you to ponder.